Loading everything at once in Unity is like carrying all your groceries in one trip. It's possible, but it's exhausting. Let's fix that with level streaming or scene streaming, which is a smarter way to manage your game world. In this video, I'll show you how scene streaming works, why it's essential for performance, and how to implement it step by step. This is the first episode in our 100 Tips in Unity series, so make sure to stick around. If you look at games like Witcher 3 or GTA 5 or even Subnautica, how do these big games manage their game world, which is huge, without causing any lag or any crashes? Well, part of that is an optimization trick called scene streaming or level streaming. So scene streaming lets you load and unload parts of your game world dynamically. Instead of loading the entire game upfront, you only load what the player needs at any given time. This keeps memory usage low and improves performance. For example, in an open world game, you can only load the areas near the player while unloading the distant areas. This makes huge worlds possible without lag and crashes. Part of level streaming is loading and unloading scenes, but all of these happens asynchronously, meaning in the background. Typically in level-based games, you would have level 1, then you'd go to a loading screen, and then you go to level 2. In this, that loading screen is not there and the transition happens very smoothly, it's very relaxed, and it's natural. So let's see how we can implement that in Unity, but also learn how to build our levels so that we can do level streaming easily. So over in Unity, we have a very basic level. By the way, I am using Free Slavic Medieval Environment by ImageArt. It's a really cool asset pack. The link is in the description. But it's actually not a single scene. So if I press Shift Spacebar, you can see that it is actually a combination of 5 different scenes. We have a main scene which contains the camera, a light, and a scene streamer which we look at in this video, a scene machine camera, and then a player. Okay, just the basic things. Then we have other scenes called Forest, Forest 2, Village, Village 2. And you can see these are the ones that contains the asset. So Forest, you can see if you disable this eye icon, it's that part. Forest 2 is on the top left, Village is on the bottom left, Village 2 is on bottom right. They're smooth, okay, there's no visual gap in between them. You can see they are separate scenes. How did I make this? You just simply create separate scenes. So here is one for Village 1, which contains a terrain and a bunch of things. And the terrain has a dimensions of 50 by 50 and a height of 600. So this is actually a very small terrain. If you look at Village 2, you can see that it is actually physically placed somewhere else. So Village 1 is over here. Village 2 is actually physically placed right next to Village 2. And what we do is typically we have a main scene here and we can just drag and drop these scenes to load them in this scene. So we have Forest, Forest 2, Village, Village 2. I can go to each scene, select just the terrain by holding Control and hit Shift H, and this is going to isolate only the terrains. You can just click on one of these terrains and then go to raise or lower terrain, and it is going to work on other terrains as well. So you can click like this and it is going to build it together, which is a great thing. I'm going to undo those changes because I already have set up the level, and that is how you create a game world. You put them all together in one scene and then you place them and then you remove them from the scene. So I'm going to press Shift H again to bring everything back, and there we go. We have the entire level split into 4 scenes, actually 5 scenes. And this is what scene streaming is about. We don't need to load them here. This won't work. You can play test it, but it's not going to work in the actual game. You need to actually dynamically load and unload scenes at runtime through code. So if I hit play, there we go. We have the level loaded. But if I separate out the scene view and if I move, let's say, to the corner like this, you can see that things that are far away are not loaded. So I could go here and these things are not loaded. So you need to plan this out so that there are no visual errors like this. You can see the outer world. Obviously, you shouldn't make the player go to the edge of the world, but still. Now, if you move, it will automatically load these assets. Yeah, this is what scene streaming is about. One of the reasons why this looks terrible here is because the depth or the area is too small. It's 50 by 50 in my case. If you make it 100 by 100, it's going to be a lot less obvious. Plus, you can also use fog to hide distant details. So how do we actually do scene streaming? Firstly, we need to create a class called SceneData, which contains a scene name and a bounds. So you can specify a bounds, which is like a cuboidal area, so sort of like a box collider. And each scene will have a scene bounds. Okay. Then we have a scene config, which is a scriptable object, which contains a list of the scene data class. Okay. We can use a create asset menu attribute to create an asset for the scene config scriptable object. Okay. And finally, this is the main class. We have a scene streamer class. It derives from mono behavior. It contains a scene config reference, and we have a load distance, and we have an unload distance. Okay. We also have a check interval, which is set to 0.5 by default, which means we don't have to do this every frame. You can do this once every second or something like that and still get away with fine results. We also have a reference to the player. At start, we find the player, and then we just make sure that all scenes are unloaded at start. So we go through all of the scenes in this scene config list, and then we unload them. And then we start a coroutine called check scenes. Okay, so how does loading and unloading take place? In Unity, there are two handy functions that helps us with it. That is scenemanager.loadsceneasync and scenemanager.unloadsceneasync. So scenemanager.loadsceneasync is just a function that we can call, and it automatically does the job. It just loads the scene in the background. That's it. And it's a very handy function. Now, both of these functions contain a parameter of type load scene mode, and we need to specify a load scene mode called load scene mode.additive, which allows us to load multiple scenes together. Now, in this coroutine, it all takes place inside a while true loop, which means this will happen forever. And in this, we go through each of these scenes in the scene config scriptable object, and then we check if the player is already inside the bounds of one of these scenes. If yes, then we load the scene. Okay, we call load scene async, and we give in a scene name, and then load scene mode dot additive. We don't need this line here. You can find this code in the GitHub link in the description. This is just basic way of doing scene streaming. This is not advanced at all. But hey, this is how you would typically start doing it. Doing it like this is also a great improvement in performance. Else, if we are outside the bounds, we actually calculate the distance to the bounds. Using these two methods, we find the closest point to the bounds, and then we calculate the distance to the bounds. And if distance to bounds is less than or equals load distance, and if it is not already loaded, we load that scene. If that distance is greater than unload distance, and if it is loaded, then we unload scene async that scene. So if the distance to the player is less than load distance, we load a scene. If the distance is greater than the unload distance, we unload the scene asynchronously. This is the basics of scene streaming. So I have a scene streamer game object, which contains the scene streamer script, and I have a load distance of 35 and an unload distance, which should be greater than load distance of 45. And we are checking it for every 0.5 seconds. So if you look at the scene config file, which I've created by right-clicking, creating scene config, and this is because of this create asset menu attribute. Then I've specified the names for my scene. So forest, forest 2, village, village 2, and I've given it proper scene bounds. So I've given it a center. So if you look at forest, if you look at the terrain, it starts at 000, but it has a width of 50 by 50. So the center will be at 25, 0, 25, and the extents will be 25. And I've given it a Y of 10 and then again 25. So basically it's like having a box collider around the entire terrain. So I've did that for all of these four scenes. I've specified the proper centers and the proper extents. If I hit play again, boom. The first scene, we are already inside the bound, so it will load. And if we go far away from one of these scenes, well enough, this will not be loaded. If I go even further from the other ones as well, it will automatically unload. Okay. So imagine that each one of these scenes are like districts inside a city, and as the player moves, the script checks their distance and loads the appropriate scenes. So instead of one giant city, it's much better to have smaller scenes, and it's also helpful with things like version control. Also, another tip for this is to go to rendering and lighting, and we could go to environment and make sure that fog is turned on. This is going to help us with the loading and unloading of assets, and fog really helps hide those subtleties in game world. Also have a bigger terrain compared to mine. Because this is very small and it's closer to the player, you can always see the loading and unloading happen. Okay, so make sure to have a bigger terrain, maybe use 100 by 100 at least, and then you're good to go. And this is how we build levels that are much more bigger in scale, but you don't have to worry a lot about crashes because they're not loaded together. There we go, that is scene streaming in Unity. So I hope this video was useful. Let me know what you think of the series of 100 tips in Unity. I would like to create one episode for each tip so that I can go in depth into it, and I want to complete them by the end of this year. That is my plan. So now that you know how to load and unload scenes dynamically, in the next video we'll talk about an optimization tip that will help improve in-editor performance. It also makes your assets and project more modular. So I'll see you in the next one. Check out the playlist. It will contain all of the videos in the series. Thank you for watching.